shows you're about to watch contain graphic adult content. Viewer discretion is advised. You're watching Hellfire TV.
When the purge concludes.
Tell you that I love your love of the type of horror that I saw in that intro. The whole gritty drive-in, that's my kind of horror, and there aren't a lot of people that really appreciate it, and I appreciate you guys for loving it.
Thank you.
That's
I grew up on it, and I am obsessed with it, and I love it, and that's why I like that.
If I could go through life like with a decayed film frame overlay, I would.
Yeah.
It's like the sprockets, and maybe it jumps a little bit out of kilter, and yeah, all
love
of
it. I would do that for sure.
Yeah, we absolutely love it. It's amazing. It's like that grindhouse, like Robert Rodriguez, Planet Terror.
Totally. Like for me, like Grindhouse, Planet Terror meets Roger Corman, Vincent Price, that whole vibe, that dark gothic mixed with the grittiness. Ooh, I'm getting excited just talking about it. Hey, I'm looking forward to being at Midwest Slaughterfest with you guys next year. Thank you for inviting me.
Absolutely. You were the first one that we even went after.
Yes. Yep.
I told you, she already knew. Like, she already knew, because, like, for me, as an actor coming up, like, you're one of my idols. And so She was like, I'm going to get Bill Oberst Jr. and not tell Scoops anything till the last minute.
Yeah. I am so glad that she did.
Yeah, I am too. Like, I've been, you know, I've watched almost everything you've been in.
Sorry about that.
Oh, no, awesome. It's amazing. Like, the one that I really have been excited about was Circus of the Dead, and I've probably watched it.
We just watched it today.
A million freaking times already, and it never gets old. I never get tired of it. And it's like one of the greatest performances I feel like I've ever seen in my life.
You mean for me?
Yes.
Dude, I have to tell you, that was all Billy Pond, because like my ideas of the character were completely wrong, and Billy set me straight, because I was thinking that he was, you know, he's a clown, so he's funny. And Billy said, no, he's a homicidal necrophiliac who happens to have a day job as a circus clown. So he could just as easily be a plumber.
Yeah.
So that gave me the idea to like make him have two personalities. One where he's like, oh, welcome to the show. And the other, he's like, I'm just messing with you, man.
It was terrifying, like downright.
He was terrifying to me too. Like when he puts the gun in the guy's mouth and says, tell him Papa sent you, in this really calm voice, that's really scary to me.
Yeah, it was like almost like a serene, like there was almost nothing there. Like you have this body, but there's, you know, knock, knock, nobody's home.
Right, exactly. Like, yo, so when they're chopping off, so Mr. Blister's sawing off the arm, and Papa's like playing with his little curl to make sure it's just right. That kind of extreme vanity to the exclusion of everything else is in itself really scary.
I watched the movie by accident. I didn't even know you were in the movie. I just seen it on Tubi. I was flipping through Tubi, and I was like, you know, I want to watch a new movie. And I seen it, and I was like, I just like the cover of it. I was like, it looks very, very gritty, something that I would like. So I watched it, and I just sat there with like my mouth open the whole time, and I'm like, this is horror. This is what a horror film should be.
That's Billy Pond.
This right here is who every horror actor should shoot to be like.
Billy's brutal, man. He's the real deal. I look forward to him making more things because he's brutal.
Yes.
I've been fortunate enough to speak to Billy on the phone like twice.
And we've interviewed him on the show.
Yeah, too. And he's been with us on the show. And we got to talk a lot about it. And he is intense. I really hope that he does a lot more stuff, and I hope to see you in a lot more stuff, because like I said, you're one of my idols. You're one of the people I look up to whenever I'm on film and doing stuff.
Thank you for that. And Circus of the Dead really set me on a path of wanting to do like more extreme things. And I've enjoyed that end of horror a lot, like artistic, very strange. Did you guys happen to see Dis?
I have not seen that yet.
Unearthed Films has it out. The director is Adrian Corona. We shot it in Mexico. It's very strange and very brutal and offensive and very artistic and almost completely unexplained. So check it out. You might enjoy it. I can't describe it in any other way than, yes, I can. It's implicit. Nothing in the movie like explains why am I watching this? And it's this young, very intense, mythological, literary type of director, Adrian Corona, and his stuff is really, really weird. I'm going to Mexico again this fall to shoot another of his movies called Dead Iris.
Nice.
About the Aztec sweat lodge culture. So I've really grown to like the strange and even the extreme, because I think horror needs to, it needs to make you completely question the grounds of your existence in order to be effective.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree.
Well, and it should make you uncomfortable. I feel like horror, that's
well, that's the whole point. Point of it. That's yeah, the whole point.
That's right. It should make you squirm, and not always in a good way, not always in the fun roller coaster way, but in the way of, oh my God, I just woke up. It's 3 a.m. I'm in the amusement park. The doors are locked and I'm naked. That kind of way.
I agree. Like, it's not supposed to be like a fucking kiddie ride.
No. Yeah.
Like, you want to leave like fucked up.
That's right.
I want you to have nightmares.
I did an art house movie with a director named Trevor Yinger. It's called Coyote, a little low budget art house, like 2014. And so it's about a guy who can't sleep and he's insane. And so Trevor edited the movie and he wrote me and he said, I'm so depressed. I said, why? He said, because watching this movie feels like you're inside mental illness. It feels like you are that sick. And I said, Trevor, that's great.
Yeah. You're like, you should feel that way.
I know. That's like, you know, I guess one of the last movies we did, they're like, you know, this scene might be a little uncomfortable. We're going to cover you in blood. And I'm like, that's not enough blood. This is not gory enough. Like, we need to push this shit. And they're like, oh, okay. we need that. Like, stop drawing horror back to where it's. You know, PG has its place with little kids. There's starter horror, but we as adults and major horror fans, we want to see that scary ass shit.
Yeah.
Like, popcorn scares shit out of me. And I loved it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was amazing, and your portrayal of it was, I don't even know what to say. Like, you fucking, you need like an Academy Award, an Oscar, or something.
Yeah.
Something. My God, you were terrifying.
Billy made me do it.
I feel like he has a way of doing that.
Yeah, Billy was like, so you like lick the window while you're watching her, like just really get that tongue and just lick it. I was like, okay.
You're like, all right.
Like, how do you put yourself in that mindset to play somebody like that?
So here's the deal. I believe that there is absolutely real evil in the world. I am a firm believer in good and evil. And so when I play evil, I have to step away from the good and surrender to it, completely surrender, knowing that I can come back, but that it's not going to be pleasant during the time that I've stepped into the evil, because I want it to be so real that people realize that it's in all of us. I don't want people thinking, oh, that's some other person who's crazy. I want them to think that is in me. So that's what I do, is I just say, I trust you and I'm going to go away now and I'm going into really dark places. And just hold me while I'm there and I'll be back. But I can't do it half-ass. I guess I'm not a good enough actor to do it half-ass. If I'm going to do it, I have to do it for real. It has to be real.
All the way.
That makes sense, though. Yeah.
It makes perfect sense. But it's like, I respect you greatly because you can come back, because others weren't able to.
Well, I don't have a cell phone on set, and I don't allow myself to be online at all because I need to completely immerse myself in it. And in some ways that helps, because you're not thinking about anything else. You're completely in it. So when it's time to leave, you're really ready to leave. I was ready to leave Papa Corn. He gave me nightmares for months afterwards. Mm-hmm. And so when you're that immersed, you're ready to be done when you're done.
Yeah.
We kind of do the same thing. We don't take our cell phones on set or anything. Like, everybody else is standing off texting and everything else. And me and her will kind of go off in our own little world, and we'll sit there and go over our lines and go over mannerisms and different stuff. And she'll look at me and be like, "Nah, that's not scary enough. Like, you need to put more into it." And
yes. And I'll tell you that I think the camera picks up that kind of intensity. The camera knows, and people watching it, they don't understand why, but they're getting something real. Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. Definitely. And you're one of those actors that just, everything's real. Everything. Like, what got you into acting? Like, what led you down this road?
Ridicule.
That's the first time we ever got that answer.
I was the most unpopular kid in the world. I was different in every way that a boy could be different growing up in the American South in the pre-internet days. And the only way that I could respond was to either just withdraw into myself or somehow become okay with these people who were terrorizing me. And I learned to be okay by learning to entertain them. And then I found out, aha, you can trick people. If you entertain them, they won't hit you. And so that started me off on the path of entertaining people just to make them accept me. And I'm still really afraid of people. I don't socialize much. I'm not comfortable at all in social situations. So when I get to work, that's my socialization. Otherwise, I'm really a hermit.
Nothing wrong with that.
That kind of sounds like us, too. To be honest.
We work, we come home.
We don't really socialize a whole lot. It's you know, out on the road, touring, horror cons, movies, back home, we're home. Like, that's it. We have each other and our kids.
Yeah, I hear you.
And that's about it, and we're good with that. And see, you're from South Carolina, correct?
Originally from the small rural state. It used to be small and rural, of South Carolina. I grew up on the coast among all these ruined plantations. The area I was from used to be a really, really big plantation area. And so now they're all golf courses and shit. But when I was a kid, they were like these old ruined falling down estates. And if you knew the caretakers, you could get onto the property and everything was overgrown and mossy and graveyards. It was a great place for a horror kid to grow up.
So I'm from South Carolina, too.
Whereabouts?
Beaufort.
Okay, sure. This right down the coast. I'm right up the coast from you in Georgetown.
Yep. I'm from Beaufort, South Carolina. My family still lives there, and I go there. We go 4 or 5 times a year to go hang out, visit.
You probably grew up hearing ghost stories, too.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Plenty of them. The old plantation, Spanish mosses, the church ruins.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
There's especially something about church ruins and especially the old church graveyards that had the stones. There's something about the headstone that's different than the flat grave marker. Some of the old churchyards are so quiet and there's something strong in the air in those places.
I've done that. I've did my little investigating through church ruins. There's some specific ones that are out near, I'm trying to think of what the little town outside of Beaufort is called, but there's a massive church ruins from back during the Civil War era. And during the day, it's not so bad, but when you go in there and that sun's starting to set, it gets, intense.
Yes.
I wasn't able to stay very long. I'm a chicken shit. I gotta go. I'm gonna pee my pants. Yeah, this is getting nuts. So if you had one role that you've never done, what's something that you would like to do before you retire?
Eric, the Phantom of the Opera. But let me explain. It doesn't have to be in an opera. What I'm talking about is the character of Eric. Originally, he was not disfigured by somebody throwing acid in his face, and he didn't have an accident. He was born that way. And he was so disfigured when he was born that his parents couldn't stand to look at him, and his mother made him wear a mask as a baby. And they sold him to this traveling carnival where he had to exhibit himself. And then he was eventually sold to a Shah in Persia. And at that's where he learned to become a magician and eventually a murderer. So, but none of the movies have been able to do that. Lon Chaney tried in 1925, but the audience at the time wouldn't accept it, the backstory, because they didn't want to have sympathy for the monster. And ever since then, every time you see Eric, it's always like, oh, somebody threw acid in his face, or oh, he had an accident. But to me, the whole beauty of Eric is that he is the original wounded monster. He was born that way. He didn't ask to be born that way. So I want some young director to take the Phantom of the Opera, rip it out of its frame. It doesn't have to be at the Opera House, but take that core story and implant it somewhere else and let me play Eric. That character, since I was a kid, has strongly resonated with my soul.
That's awesome.
That is awesome. I love the Phantom of the Opera. So
it's been a very long time since I've seen it. The last one I seen was one that was like a Western version, and it was done in the mid-90s. And I cannot remember who played him, but it was pretty good. It was a different spin on it.
So, well, in the 1925 version, which I first saw projected onto a sheet from 16 millimeter one Halloween, in this unmasking scene, she rips his mask off, and Chaney throws Mary Philbin to the ground, and he really throws her. I mean, she really hits her ass. You know, they didn't have stunt people. And he looks down at her, and he's got this mixture of anger and hurt. And that's that mixture that, to me, like the mixture of malevolence and woundedness together at the same time, that's what I strive to put into every character that I do. And I call it the wounded monster. It's that I'm hurt and I'm going to hurt you, but I'm hurt at the same time. That together is the gold standard to me for a character.
That's awesome.
That is amazing. I don't know what I would want to. I want to be a werewolf.
That too.
I want to be a werewolf. Like,
but you
I
know,
wanna...
you're sort of trapped with the werewolf, right? Unless you got a lot of money, you have to find a way to do the transformation in a cool way.
Yeah.
Oh, it would have to be like American Werewolf in London.
Okay.
I love that film. Like, that is the greatest transformation scene ever. Like,
I agree.
I don't know. There's something about being a werewolf and getting to be like that, like intense and the rage and the savagery of it. I don't know. I feel like it would be therapeutic.
Yeah,
absolutely.
That would be amazing. I gotta learn to be like Bill and like really like get in there.
I think you already are.
You're probably right. Definitely with this character, because I've been this character for how long have I been this character? How long have we been these characters?
Like 4 years.
Okay. Yeah. That's kind of cheating, though. We've been playing over
Yeah, they kind of, yeah. No, that doesn't count.
We're good.
You know what I was thinking about looking at you guys? I'm a big EC horror comics fan, and there's a great EC story where this guy, he's at a carnival like in New Orleans, and there's this beautiful woman, but she's wearing this like crone hag mask. But otherwise, she's absolutely beautiful. And so he dates her. And anyway, they end up getting married, and she keeps saying, I'll take off the mask. And so finally, he can't stand it anymore. And he starts pulling at her face, saying, I have to see, I have to take off the mask. But it wasn't a mask, and he ripped her face off.
That's awesome.
Is amazing.
I was going to say, I don't think we've taken your nose off yet. Oop, there you go.
It's been so long since you've done that, I forgot my nose is removable.
You're like, oh no. No, it comes off.
I know you got questions. I'm sitting here being a fucking...
You asked mine, about. Actually.
Which one?
What role he would like to play. Oh. So when was your first film? How old were you?
I did theater for 14 years before I ever did a film. So the very first thing that I ever did was 2007, and it was for the History Channel. I played General William Sherman. And that same year, I did my first horror movie, which was called Dismal. And I played a cannibal park ranger. And yeah, that was the first time that I actually licked a girl's face and the first time that I ate human flesh. And so it was a special time.
Nice.
Sounds very special.
Sounds like a lot of boxes checked
in. All in one movie.
That's the first time that I wore a wife beater. And so from then on, in so many damn movies, like, they'll be like, we're not quite sure what your wardrobe's going to be. And I'm thinking, it's going to be a wife beater. And they'll be like, we're not sure what we're going to do. And then when I get there on the day, they're like, here, wear this wife beater. I have right there in my dresser, I have like three bloody wife beaters for when I have to do auditions and stuff, because I figure just, you know, go ahead and pre-bloody them up and just stick them in the drawer.
You're like, they're ready to go. Just
that's a fantastic idea, because we have the same thing with zombies.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I literally have like distressed ones over on the table across from like our studio, and it's like zombie clothes that we just have. Because
I know. So like,
we've been zombies the last two projects.
If a regular person came in your house, they'd be like, what the hell?
Yes. Oh, they would. Oh, they would.
Yes. We have like cleavers and all sorts of stuff hanging on the walls, like stuff that's been signed from other actors and stuff. Yeah, I'm sure. I know when my parents come over, they're like, where did we go wrong?
I know. Mine too.
I was like, my mother is a retired judge, and my father is a force lieutenant in South Carolina for the police department.
Love it.
And they're like,
and then there's you.
What the fuck? What does your son do for a living? Well,
my father still tells me I need to get a real job. Still.
What?
That's what fathers are supposed to do, right?
I guess, yeah.
I feel
they're
like we
to
have...
tell you that they're supposed to tell you that you wasted your life and you're going to end up sleeping in a cardboard box. At least fathers of my generation.
That's horrible.
Well, my dad was very, very supportive.
Yeah.
My mom, not so much.
Definitely not.
She's better with it now.
Yeah.
Than she was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Way better. How did you break it to your parents? Like, hey, I want to be an actor.
My father always knew I wanted to be an actor from the time I was a kid, because my first desire was to be in a special effects makeup artist. I was very into that, and so I ordered all the stuff that you could get in those days. I got the Dick Smith makeup course, and I took one of my father's old fishing tackle boxes and made my makeup kit. And I remember once I was trying to do a Quasimodo makeup and trying to do the drooped eye. And my father came in and he looked at me with the makeup kit set up and the plastic and the blood. And he said, you're a weird kid, Billy. And so he knew from an early age. And that's why I used the junior as sort of a tribute to him, so he'll never be confused with an actor.
I don't know if that's good or far. It's horrible. that is awesome, because I was kind of the same way. I was really into the special effects, like specifically how they for instance, I really loved the movie Puppet Master when I was a little kid from Full Moon Productions. And they always had like the behind the scenes, like after the movie was over, and they had like these little special, like 30-minute documentaries on how they made it. And I was obsessed with it. And I would try to like make my own dolls so I could try to like puppeteer. That's awesome. And give them voices and stuff like that. And I would act like I was in the movies, and I got the same thing. It was, you're playing with dolls. That's a fucking weird kid.
You'll appreciate this, Dan. Okay, so I'm 14 years old, and I read about this stuff called naturoplasto, mortician's wax, which they use to reconstruct parts of faces, and it was state of the art at the time. and he was very pliable. So, and I thought, oh my God, if I had this, I can make anything I want. It's so soft. It looks like flesh. Where do I get it? Well, you could only get it through if you were a licensed mortician back then. So 14 years old, I borrowed my mother's typewriter, typed out a letter, fake, saying that my dad ran a funeral home. The whole thing, it completely lied, and mailed it off, and they called, and, I said, hello, and then, oh, is this the so-and-so funeral home? And I said, oh, yes, I'm sorry, so-and-so funeral home. Anyway, so I managed to get this stuff that you could only get from the morticians. Then I find out that it's so soft, it's fantastic, but if you touch it, it squeezes, you can't seal it. So then I look in this mortician's catalog, which I was now getting regularly in the mail at age 14, with coffins and all this stuff, embalming fluid. And I see this stuff that's a fixative for mortician's wax. And it says, absolutely, we'll seal mortician's wax, solid to the touch. And I was like, oh, thank you, God, this is great. So I order this stuff and I can't wait every day. And then it finally comes in. And I look at it, and the first thing I see is this big skull and crossbones, and it says, caution, do not use on live tissue. I'm like,
what's the point?
Dang.
Yeah, what? If I can't use it on live tissue, what's the point?
So, yeah. I would have been very, very pissed off.
That's genius, though. 14 years old, you pretended to have your own...
Oh, I would tell any lie to get a cool horror thing or something I was not supposed to have. Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. I would the exact same way. Exact. It's like I'm listening to my, own life. It's weird. I'm still weird.
Yeah, well, I don't think you grow out of that.
No,
you shouldn't. You shouldn't.
No. I nobody ever grows out of it. Like, you're either in it and you're in it forever, or you're just not.
But horror people are the nicest people. And I think it's because we're comfortable with death. We like to take death in our hands like Plato and play with it. And it makes us more chill about life because we know death is coming. We've played with it many, many times, and we're not so uptight about it.
I can agree with that. I never really thought about that. I never thought about that. That makes a whole lot of sense.
Yeah.
I know you got a few more questions.
Do I?
You always do.
We'd be here for 3 hours if I asked all the questions that are in my brain. So do you only do horror, or do you kind of jump genres, or are you mostly...
I do. As a working actor, I'll do what they hire me to do, but what they hire me to do is horror. Even if I'm in a straight film, I'm going to play usually the bad guy, the heavy. But that's just because my face has all the markers. There are, scientific, research on what faces you should not trust. And I have, you should not trust this. don't trust this. The camera loves to see my face play in somebody you shouldn't trust, because it allows people who are watching it to say, aha, my suspicions were right. You couldn't trust him. There's something in the human brain. We really like archetypes. And I'm the archetype of the guy who you should not trust, no matter what he says. So I usually end up mostly doing horror, which is a blessing because I love horror.
That's awesome. But yeah. I feel like I would be offended if I grew up that way.
Why?
Like, you just look like you should be a bad person.
Absolutely. When I was just getting started in LA and going out for a lot of auditions, I'd be there and they'd be like, oh, you're here for the rapist? That's in room two.
Man, you were stereotyped real fast.
Pedophile priest, yeah, that's you over here, buddy, right there. Yeah.
Oh, there's Joe Lujan. Oh,
yeah. You're the weirdo. We can look at you and just tell.
Thank
you. Like that nope. The minute you want, oh yeah, that's a murderer. Just go down the room too. You're good.
You're good.
You already have the part, but go ahead. There you go.
That's right. You know what I have found is most uncomfortable on screen is too close proximity. Like, we have this idea of space between humans, and so I use it a lot, just doing nothing but getting close to a person on screen, closer than you should be, and not blinking. That in and of itself can lay a foundation of weirdness.
Yeah.
I don't have eyes.
You don't have eyes right now, no.
I can't do that.
You still could. Yeah, it's just personal space. Yeah, I totally agree. I'm that way in public. I'm like, arm's distance, please.
Yeah, like if someone gets very close to you and they're quiet for a moment and then they say, could I ask you something? It's like instant alarm bells go off.
You're like, panic.
Well, I just shit my pants.
But go ahead, sure.
Yep, go ahead. It's too late now.
You know what the good thing is about looking like this? You never get bothered on the street. You never, nobody ever thinks they will take advantage of you. They pull their children away from you, but nobody is ever going to like think, oh, I can roll right over that person. They give you a wide swath.
This is true.
That's good, I guess.
This is true.
There are perks. That's what you're saying. There are perks.
Except for the one time that we were going to somewhere and the man rolled down the window and told me I was the coolest thing he ever seen.
Great.
That only happened one time, though.
Some people are weird.
That was it. And then there was a lady that tried to tase me. That kind of sucked.
Oh, wow.
Just slightly.
Now, is there a line that you wouldn't cross or a role you would turn down or any, you know, anything like that?
Who, me?
Yeah. Like, is there a line for you of like, I won't do this. Like, this is an absolute.
The fact that I have to think about it probably means no.
Yeah, I guess
if it serves the story, and the story is a story that fits into the character, if it's all authentic and real, then no.
Have you ever turned down anything before?
Yes. I have turned down a couple of things for ministers. And I've played priest, and I like to play priests and ministers. But people who claim to be really, really close to God and in touch with God, but are liars and hurt people. I've done one of those roles. It was Father Simon and Children of Sorrow, but I find them really, I guess because of my faith, I find them, you can go too far. And I know there are people like that in the world, but I don't want to add to that stereotype. But if it's like, if it's either a strictly good priest doing an exorcism, I'm good. Or if it's a strictly evil priest, that's fine. But it's the ones who say, there's never any indication that they're evil. The implication is that only because they are professing to serve God that makes them evil. I'm not explaining it very well, but that I guess that's the only little minute fine area that I'm not comfortable in. I don't think that just because a person has spiritual beliefs or believes that there is a creator, I don't think that that makes them intrinsically evil is what I'm saying.
Right. Yeah, no, that makes sense.
I totally get it.
Yeah.
It doesn't make them intrinsically good, but it doesn't make them like The Exorcist, right? You have strong good and strong evil, and they're battling it. At the end, you don't know which one won. That's the gold standard for me. If you don't have strong good and strong evil, if you only have evil, then, you know, it can get pretty cliche.
Yeah.
Well, and, yeah, that would be like having Star Wars and not having either the Jedi or the Sith. Yeah. It would be kind of redundant.
Yeah.
Boring. Anyways, do you have anything you want to throw out there? Do you have any projects coming up you want to talk about? You want people to go watch? Anything like that?
I've got a couple of shoots coming up. I'm doing a movie called Bloodspawn, which I hope people follow on social media. I'm doing Dead Irish. down in Mexico coming up. I'm going to Czechoslovakia or maybe Poland, or I think it's Poland, somewhere in Eastern Europe, to play Hitler, actually, in a straight World War II drama. And, wow. And that I'm really looking forward to. But you know the thing I'd like to mention? I have a podcast called Gothic Goodnight. And I started it during COVID, and the whole first season is online. I'm getting ready to start the second season. But it's a bedtime podcast. So, like, my idea was that during this really stressful time, people were having trouble falling asleep. And so I would take these short pieces of Gothic dark fiction and read them in the persona of this old library keeper in an ancient forgotten library. And they're short and they're guaranteed to put you to sleep. And I would like people to check them out. If you just, any of your podcast providers, just look for Gothic Goodnight, and all 13 of the first episodes are there. My favorite one is the Phantom of the Opera episode. But there's a lot of my heart and my soul in Gothic Goodnight, and I wish people would check it out. Take me to bed with you is what I'm saying.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Do that. Go check it out. We're going to check it out tonight now that we know about it.
Absolutely. I'm definitely going to. Well, it has been an absolute pleasure and a blast. We're so glad that you came on here to talk with us and hang out for a little bit.
Thank you, and I can't wait to see your eyes.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Soon enough.
Absolutely.
For everybody. You guys are great. I can't wait to come to Slaughterfest, and thank you again for this opportunity. I love you.
Absolutely. Thank you. We love you too. For you guys that are watching, thank you for joining us tonight, and we will see you next Monday.
Bye.
You. When I'm screaming, fuck you. Middle finger in the air, and all I wanted to hear was you screaming, fuck you too. Yeah, I'm running in a stratosphere, in a brand new room atmosphere. I wanna go and shoot to the campus clear, cause I never thought I would've made it out of here alive. From the land where the people put the evil in that ride. You'll never see an equal to my kind, so blind to anything to line the lights of mind is right now. Looking for another mind to fight foul, bringing everything that you can bring down to the ground. Like 150 pounds of C-Torn, looking for keyboard thugs. Well, I'ma need more slugs, cause I wanna see more blood. You ain't never seen gold like us. They don't wanna make them any more like us. Put them on tour with the paint on them, and anybody can know your little lame song. Fuck Ryan, I'ma stay wrong. Blackout with a ray gun, looking for anybody to make up. Motherfucking really need to wake up.